I'm extremely satisfied with my oncologist. I know that part of that is because I was comfortable telling him from the beginning that I'm a lesbian and that my partner is going to be included in the discussions and going to be at the appointments. I'm also extremely comfortable with his physician assistant. Not everybody is. I know some people who only want to deal with their physician oncologist. They don't want to deal with a nurse practitioner or a physician assistant. I think a couple of things really that they've helped me with. My oncologist told me at the very beginning that he does not deal in statistics or numbers or life expectancies. We did discuss what those are, which for a five-year survival rate, the five-year survival rate is 22 to 36% for people with metastatic breast cancer. We discussed that, and then we didn't linger on it. He said, I don't deal with life expectancies. We're going to treat you as long as we can treat you, and if something doesn't work, we'll change and try something different. And we'll keep trying until you don't want to try anymore, or until, I mean, there's not currently a cure. Just the fact that he said, we're going to keep treating you, we're going to just take it each day by day, each appointment by appointment, helped tremendously.
Our medical training and the way we practice medicine in the United States is mainly focused on treating a disease. But what patients really want to know is how they can live their lives as close to normal as possible. So it's an ongoing struggle that we have to think more holistically. And part of that, I think, has to do with our training, and training is changing a little bit. On the other hand, medical oncology is becoming phenomenally more complicated. There's so much more to know, and there's so many more things you have to keep in mind just for the specifics of treating a patient as best you can, which is what we try to do. But it's not just about the medical model. That's what we're learning. And so I think there are different ways to accomplish that. One way is the team approach. I might just not have enough time to see my patients that I need to and make the right treatment decisions for them, but I need to know about what their aspirations are, what are the important goals they have for their life after they're diagnosed with cancer, what their life was like before cancer, because that's really, they've had a whole life before cancer. I'm coming in at just this one point and focusing on the disease. We've got to go beyond that. And so, by whatever means necessary, we need to know what the patient's desires are. And that's called shared decision making.
The biggest thing, especially if you have an earlier stage of cancer, you might deal with your oncology team for 6 months or a year or maybe 5 years because you're doing follow-ups. But eventually you're moving on from them. People with metastatic breast cancer, we're with this team for the rest of my life. Essentially, unless you change doctors or change clinics or decide to stop doing treatment. So I really think that if they can get to know us as people, and of course everybody's pushed for time and everybody, you know, is trying to get as many people through as possible, but just to take that few minutes to find out what's important to them, what they're willing to put up with, because there's certain things that I won't do because it'll affect my quality of life.
We need to know more about lifestyles. Caregivers help there, patients help, but the patient also is thinking about their disease at that time, and they may not have the opportunity to talk to you about their life, particularly in the first few encounters. As time goes on, I think physicians need to open up, and as the relationship flowers and trust builds, let's talk about your life and, you know, how are things really going now that we're on this treatment. So I think we can get there. But there's more work to be done.
When I had to have the hysterectomy, one of the things we talked about with the surgeon was the possibility of doing a colostomy. And I said, absolutely not. And would not sign the paperwork agreeing to that. And my surgeon said, you're telling me you would rather be dead than have a colostomy. And I said, I am telling you for myself, I would rather be dead than have the colostomy bag because I cannot live the way I want to live and do the things I want to do with that. So I think those are the kind of conversations that oncologists have to have with their patients. That and end-of-life conversations and talking about do not resuscitate orders and things like that, because those aren't comfortable conversations. I think one big thing that I would say for physicians to keep in mind is that Western medicine is not everything. I certainly partake in Western medicine. I practice it myself. I believe it has a strong purpose and can definitely help with a lot of things, but I also believe that there are other aspects of care that can be incorporated to that. And I think if physicians were a little bit more open to those conversations, one, they would know more what their patients are doing, because I think there are some patients who practice some alternative things and don't tell their oncologist because they're afraid of what they're going to say. I definitely think, and I do this myself as a healthcare provider, I think there is very much a tendency to get wrapped up in the protocols and the treatments, and you look at a set of signs and symptoms and go, oh, I know what medicine can treat that. I know how to fix this, because that's what you want to do. You want to fix it. And I think that's one of the difficulties with metastatic cancer is it's not fixable in terms of we're not going to cure you and you're going to go on your merry way. It's we're going to treat you and try to stabilize you and try to extend your life as long as possible. I would imagine it's difficult as a physician to go, oh, I can't cure this person. But I do think that there's a large tendency to just look at protocols and treatments and go, okay, we're going to do this, and we're going to do this, and we're going to do this. And sometimes they forget that the person on the other side of that has a say in it.